St. Mirren was a native of Ireland and was educated at the monastery of Bangor, where later he was prior. But like many others, he became restless and took to wandering. He finally settled in Paisley and built a church by the side of the White Cart. He is regarded as patron of the town and figures in the common seal of the borough. Paisley Abbey was founded in 1163 by Walter Fitzalan, first High Steward of Scotland. Walter, the sixth High Steward, married Marjorie, daughter of King Robert the Bruce, in 1315. A year later, Marjorie died after a fall from her horse at Gallow Hill. She left an infant son, born after she died, at Paisley Abbey. He became King Robert II, the first of the Royal House of Stuart. Paisley Abbey is known as the cradle of the Stuart King. The tune St. Mirren was written by Robert Smith, the son of a silk weaver. He was precentor at Session Clerk of the Abbey Church. We associate Paisley with the beautiful Paisley shawls, now collector's pieces. The old weavers' cottages are still seen in Kilbarkin. The weavers themselves were remarkable men, meeting together after work to improve their minds in reading and discussion. One of them, Robert Tannehill, wrote of the wood near his home. The broom, the briar, the birkin bush, bloom bonny o'er thy flowery lea, and all the sweet that e'en can wish, free nature's hand are strewed in thee. Free nature's hand are strewed in thee, thy bonny wood o' Craigielea. Well, bonny wood o' Craigielea, near thee I passed life's early day, and won my Mary's heart in thee. A housing estate now stands in the bonny woods of Craigielea. Within the parish of Paisley is Aldersley, the birthplace of William Wallace. Wallace refused to make submission to Edward I of England, the hammer of the Scots. He aroused the Scots to fight for their independence. After many successes, he was betrayed and finally beheaded. These were dark days for Scotland. In the middle of the 6th century, on the bank of the Millendinner stream, a small wooden church and monastery were erected by St. Kentigern, sometimes called Mungo. Tradition tells us that his mother was cast out by her family and put to sea in a frail skiff. It drifted on to the coast near Culross, and her son was born in the shore. He was brought up by St. Serf and trained for the priesthood. Stories are told of his miraculous powers. Mungo conducted several missions, travelling south to Cumberland and as far afield as Wales, where he founded a small community. Later he returned to Glasgow, and from there he organised missions, carrying the light of the Christian faith across the length and breadth of the land. St. Mungo is buried beneath the floor of Glasgow Cathedral. The motto of the city is "Let Glasgow Flourish." And by the preaching of the word, with its shipbuilding, trade and commerce, Glasgow has flourished. The Song of the Clyde tells its own story. Columba was of royal birth, and his name means dove. But there was nothing dove-like about the young Columba. He had a quick temper and was a ready fighter. Even after he trained as a priest, he couldn't resist becoming involved in a feud. Blood was shed and he was banished from Ireland. Columba was heartbroken, leaving his homeland. With 12 companions, but Ireland was still visible in the distance. Columba could not bear to look at it. Once more, he set sail and landed in the Isle of Iona. He climbed to the highest point of the island and looked towards the horizon. Ireland could no longer be seen. He settled in this green and fertile island with its white sands and shining pebbles, and built a small wooden church, huts for his monks, barns and stables, and a tiny guest house. He said of Iona, "Unto this place, small and mean though it be, great homage shall be paid not only by kings and peoples of the Scots, but by rulers of foreign nations. In great veneration shall it be held by men of other churches." The Christian settlement was raided many times. The monks were killed, the church burnt, and finally the abbey itself became a ruin. But the old prophecy has come true. In Iona of my heart, Iona my love, instead of monks' voices shall be the lowing of cattle, but ere the world come to an end, Iona shall be as it was. The abbey is rebuilt, and once again the pilgrims come from near and far to Iona. For 1400 years it has been the centre of Christian faith, and the Iona community still continue the work started by Columba. The ancient kings of Scotland were brought for burial in Iona. Columba made many journeys to the neighbouring islands and mainland. Fingal's Cave would have been a familiar sight to him. This is the cave which inspired Mendelssohn to compose his Scottish Overture. At this time the Picts and Scots were killing each other, and Columba set out to visit King Brude at Inverness. It was a dangerous mission through wild and lonely country. He came to Loch Ness and found the inhabitants in great fear of a beast who attacked them. Suddenly it appeared out of the water with gaping mouth and roaring loudly. St. Columba made the sign of the cross and told it to go back. It disappeared, but it still seems Nessie still exists. Columba met King Brude, but did not convert him, but he did manage to bring about a better understanding between the Picts and the Scots. Near Inverness is Culloden, and Burns's poem, The Lovely Lass o' Inverness, reminds us of Drumossie Moore. The lovely lass o' Inverness, nae joy nor pleasure can she see, for e'en and morn she cries alas, and aye the sot tear blinds her ee. Drumossie Moor, Drumossie Day, a waeful day it was to me, for there I lost my father dear, and brethren three. Of course, Drumossie Moor is Culloden Field, where the Highland clans, fighting under Prince Charles Edward Stuart, were finally defeated. Their emblem was the white rose, so tellingly described by Hugh MacDiarmid. The rose of all the world is not for me. I want for my part only the little white rose of Scotland that smells sharp and sweet and breaks the heart. There were many broken hearts after Culloden. After this inland journey we returned to the enchanting isles of the west. Crimson and gold, pure gold as the sun wakes over the seas, crimson and golden fire, sunrise, and the Hebrides. Long before the missionaries set foot in the islands, stones were set up for pagan worship, and the ancient circles are still to be seen. Gaelic is spoken, and the sound of the wind and the sea is heard in the music of the Hebrides. The songs are handed down from generation to generation, and they have been preserved for all time by Marjorie Kennedy Fraser, who wrote down the music as the songs were sung. Here is one of them.